Okay, so today we'll talk about the circulation. You know that circulation is a part of cardiovascular function. Cardiovascular system consists of heart and the blood vessels, and blood vessels are the structures in which the blood circulates throughout the body. So we will talk about the circulation, different types of circulation in our body. Then we'll talk about the arterial and venous systems in our body. Then we'll talk about the important differences between artery and vein. And then we'll move to identify the important arteries in our body. You know that we have many arteries in our body. We'll only try to identify the important or major arteries in our body. Then we'll identify the important veins in our body. Then we'll talk about a structure, arterial structure, that is called the circle of Willis. Circle of Willis is formed by a number of arteries at the base of the brain, the bottom of the brain. And from that circle, or circle of Willis, blood goes to the brain. Okay? So we'll see how the circle of Willis looks like and formed. Then we'll talk about the hepatic portal circulation. So first we'll talk about different types of circulation. First, in human body, two types of circulation are present: adult circulation and fetal circulation. In adult human body, the circulations are adult circulations that include systemic circulation, pulmonary circulation, and portal circulation. So those are present in adult body. And fetal circulation is the circulation of blood between the mother and the fetus. You know that fetus is the baby inside the uterus, mother's body, and the blood circulation between the mother and the fetus is the fetal circulation, only present in the fetus, not present in the adults. So fetal circulation is in the fetus. Other three circulations are present in the adult, in anybody after the fetus. Now we'll talk about the blood vessels. You know that blood vessels include the arteries, veins, and capillaries, right? So those are the blood vessels. What's the definition of an artery? An artery is the blood vessel that takes the blood away from the heart. So blood will go away from the heart in the artery. Veins are the blood vessels that bring the blood towards the heart. So inside the vein, the blood will move towards the heart. So arteries will take the blood away from the heart. Veins will bring the blood towards the heart. We don't care what type of blood is that. Okay? So only the definition is who is taking away, who is bringing towards the heart. That's the definition. So, in case of systemic circulation, you know that arteries carry oxygenated blood, right? And in case of pulmonary circulation, arteries carry deoxygenated blood. So arteries can carry both oxygenated or deoxygenated. It doesn't matter. Matter is who is taking the blood away, who is bringing the blood towards the heart. Okay. Now, if you ask somebody outside that what type of blood the arteries carry. Most of the people will answer oxygenated, right? Oxygen arteries carry oxygen-rich blood. The reason is, when we talk about the arteries and veins, usually we talk about systemic circulation, the systemic blood vessels, right? We don't usually talk about the pulmonary, we talk about systemic, that circulates everywhere in the body. That's why, right? That's not true always. Okay, capillaries are the blood vessels through which the exchange of gas, nutrients, metabolic wastes take place. So through the wall of the capillaries, the exchange of important chemicals take place. Arteries and veins only transport the blood from one place to another place, carry the blood from one place to another place. Usually, through the wall of the arteries and veins, no exchange takes place. Exchange takes place through the wall of the capillaries between the blood and the tissue. Okay. Three types of arteries are present in our body. The largest arteries, example, aorta, right? Aorta is the largest artery. Pulmonary arteries, pulmonary tract. Those large arteries are called conducting arteries. Another name of conducting arteries is elastic arteries. So conducting or elastic arteries are the large arteries close to the heart or directly attached to the heart. Example, your aorta, your pulmonary trunk, pulmonary arteries. Why these arteries are called elastic arteries? The reason is, if you see the wall of the conducting arteries, you will find lot of elastic fibers. That's why these arteries are also called elastic arteries. Why the elastic tissue is present there? A lot of elastic tissue is present there. The reason is, you know that elastic tissue gives what? Elasticity, right? So the arteries can expand and recoil. And that property should be present in the large arteries. Why? You know that when your heart pumps the blood very forcefully, a lot of blood suddenly gets out, right? And enters into the elastic arteries. Now, if the elastic arteries cannot expand, then a lot of blood will not enter into it, will come back into the heart. Make sense? So, the elastic property of the wall of elastic arteries reduces the resistance, because they can expand and take a lot of blood inside. If resistance is more, then the blood will go back into the heart. We don't want that. To accommodate the blood, sudden entrance of blood, the elastic arteries have elastic fibers. Next, distributing arteries. Distributing arteries receive blood from the elastic arteries and distribute the blood through the organs. For example, your kidneys, your pancreas, your stomach, those are the organs, your liver. So distributing arteries will get the blood from the elastic arteries or conducting arteries and distribute the blood to the organs. Okay? And distributing arteries are also called muscular arteries. The reason is, if you see the wall, you will find more muscular tissue or muscle tissue is present in these arteries. More muscle tissue is present in the wall. That's why these arteries are called also called muscular arteries. And then the smallest arteries are called arterioles. So arterioles are the smallest arteries. For example, after the distributing arteries take the blood to the organs, then inside the organ, the arteries further divide into small arteries, right? Further divide into small arteries, and those smallest arteries are called the arterioles. So largest are conducting, then medium-sized are the distributing, and the smallest are the arterioles. Okay? And where the arterioles end, you see here the elastic arteries or conducting arteries, then vascular or distributing arteries, and then the arterioles. Then where the arterioles end, the capillaries start. So capillaries are the blood vessels start from the end of the arterioles, and usually capillaries get interconnected, form networks, and those networks of capillaries or capillary blood vessels are called capillary beds. So capillary beds are formed by the interconnected capillary blood vessels. So this is the capillary bed. Usually capillary blood vessels form bed, but not always. Sometimes the capillary may not form the capillary bed. Without forming the capillary bed, the capillary blood vessel can go to the venules. From the arterioles, capillary can go to the venules without participating in the formation of the capillary bed or network. Okay, so just remember that. Usually, capillary blood vessels form beds called capillary bed. And exchange of the chemicals occur in the wall of the capillary, we know that. So outside of the capillary, you have the cells or tissue, and between the blood and the tissue, the exchange takes place here in the capillary bed. For example, the oxygen-rich blood will enter here, and oxygen will get out from the capillary, will enter into the tissue, and from the tissue, carbon dioxide will enter into the capillary, and the blood will become deoxygenated and carbon dioxide rich. Okay? And then what will happen? That carbon dioxide rich blood will enter into the venule. Venule is the smallest vein. So smallest veins are called venules. Okay? So venules will get blood from the capillaries and will drain the blood, deoxygenated blood, carbon dioxide rich blood, into the small veins. And then small veins will drain the blood into larger veins. Okay? And then larger veins will drain the blood into the right atria. Two largest veins are superior and inferior vena cava, right? So those are the largest veins. They will take the blood from the other veins and will drain the deoxygenated blood into the right atria. So that's the complete circulation, right? So from the heart, from the left ventricle of the heart, blood will enter into the conducting arteries in case of systemic circulation. Then from the conducting arteries, the branches will go to the organs. Those are called what? Distributing arteries, right? And then the smallest artery is called the arteriole. Then will form the capillary bed, usually. And then capillary bed will drain the blood into the venule. And the venule will drain the blood into the small veins. And from the small veins, the blood will enter into the larger veins. And larger vein will, two largest vein will drain the blood into the right atria, superior and inferior vena cava. So that's the
arterial and venous circulation. Now we'll see the wall of different types of arteries. If you see the wall of elastic artery, wall of an elastic artery, you will see a lot of elastic fibers. Just focus on these two. This is the blue one is the elastic fiber, and red one is the muscle, smooth muscle tissue. Okay, elastic tissue and smooth muscle tissue. In case of elastic artery, the elastic tissue amount should be high. But of course, the muscle tissue is also present there, a lot of muscle tissue. Now, if you see the muscular artery, you see the muscle tissue amount is more than the amount of muscle tissue in the elastic artery. But the elastic tissue amount is less than the elastic artery. Make sense? So in elastic artery, the elastic tissue is more. In muscular artery, the muscle tissue, smooth muscle tissue is more. Just remember those two. Here you see the wall of
Did you say that in elastic artery, elastic tissue is greater than the smooth?
Not greater than the smooth.
Greater than the
proportionately
greater than the muscular.
Yes.
So if you compare the elastic amount here and here, it's more, right? So muscle tissue is always more than the elastic tissue because the wall of the blood vessel is mainly muscular one.
Okay. Now,
if you see the wall of the capillary wall is extremely thin, very thin, and is formed by usually a single layer of endothelium, single layer of squamous, simple squamous epithelium. And you see the squamous type of epithelial cells, flat, right, form single layer attached to the basement membrane, that's the wall of the capillary. Now, in the wall of the venule wall is also very thin. You will see the epithelial lining, as well as you will see a special type of cells, those are called pericytes. Just write it down that you will find pericytes, some special type of cells.
Could you write that on the board?
I think P E R I C Y T E.
Then the wall of the vein.
The wall of the vein is thinner than the wall of an artery. And if you see here, the amount of muscle tissue is less compared to the wall of the artery. You have seen the, remember the wall of the artery, the muscle tissue was a lot, right? A lot of muscle tissue was there. But if you see here, in the wall of the vein, the amount of muscle tissue is less compared to the artery. And
the fibrous tissue is more in the wall of the vein. Here you see the pericytes, those are the cells, the venules, wall of the venules. And large venules have one or two layers of smooth muscle cells. Okay. Now, we'll talk about some important differences between the artery and the vein.
Number one, if I ask you, what's the difference between an artery and a vein? You can say the definitions, right? Arteries are the blood vessels that take the blood away from the heart. And veins are the blood vessels that bring the blood towards the heart. That is number one difference, right? Number two, you can say in systemic circulation, arteries carry what type of blood? Oxygenated blood. In case of
pulmonary circulation, arteries carry deoxygenated blood, right? That is another difference, you can say. Arteries, if you see the wall of an artery, the wall is much thicker than the wall of a vein. So the wall of an artery is thicker and the wall of a vein is thinner, right? So that is another difference. Since the wall of an artery is thick, the lumen inside the artery should be small or big? Small, because the wall is taking a lot of space, right? So since the wall is thick, the lumen in the artery is smaller compared to the lumen or opening inside the vein, because the wall of the vein is thin. Which one will stay open, round open? If just think that the tube, there are two tubes, one has thick wall and another has very thin wall. Which one will stay open round? Thicker one, right? That's the common sense. Thicker one will not collapse, will stay open. So the although the lumen in artery is small, but round and open, okay? But the lumen of the vein is bigger, but if it, no blood is there, it will be flat and irregular. Make sense? Flat and irregular. So that is another difference. And inside the artery, the pressure of blood is higher. Inside the artery, the blood pressure is higher than inside the vein. That makes sense. Because when your heart pumps forcefully, the blood enters into artery or vein first? Artery, right? When your heart pumps, the blood enters into the artery. So the pressure should be higher in the artery. Then from the arteries, the blood will enter into the capillaries, will get slow, right? Much slower, because it will pass through the capillaries and then will enter into the vein. When the blood will enter into the vein, the blood is very slow, pressure is very low, because it's far from the heart, right? So inside the arteries, the blood pressure is higher. Inside the veins, the blood pressure is lower, or blood pressure is less. Inside the large veins, particularly the large veins in your lower part of the body, you will see valves, presence of valves. Valves are present in the large veins, particularly in the lower part of the body. Why? The valves, you know that the pressure of blood is low inside the vein, right? And from the vein, the blood should go to the heart. And veins will take the blood towards the heart, but against the gravitation, from the lower part of the body, the veins have to take the blood towards the heart, right? So it's against the gravitation, gravity. And pressure is low. So those valves are very helpful, because they are like this, and they will prevent the backflow of the blood. When the blood will move, these valves will prevent the backflow of the blood. We'll let the blood move towards the heart. We'll have the blood to move towards
the heart. So are there fewer valves in veins draining from like
upper part? Yeah, almost no valves. But in your leg, if you see the great saphenous vein or other large veins, a lot of valves are there, okay? So those are the important differences between the arteries and veins. Now we'll talk about the differences between pulmonary and systemic circulation. First, the definition. Pulmonary circulation is the circulation between the heart and lungs, right? You know that. Between the heart and the lungs. Systemic circulation is the circulation between the heart and the body. Number one. Number two, in pulmonary circulation, arteries carry deoxygenated blood and veins carry oxygenated blood. In systemic circulation, it is opposite. The arteries carry oxygenated blood and veins carry deoxygenated blood. In case of pulmonary circulation, the pressure of blood is less than the systemic circulation. That is very reasonable, because heart pumps in pulmonary circulation, heart pumps to send the blood to where? In pulmonary? To the lungs, right? And lungs are just beside the heart, both sides of the heart. So heart need to pump forcefully. So the pressure, less pressure will take the blood from the heart to the lungs. That's why the pressure, low pressure system, pulmonary circulation is a low pressure circulation. In case of systemic, you know that left ventricle is very, wall is very thick and powerful and contracts very forcefully. So the pressure inside the systemic circulation is high pressure system. Pulmonary circulation is short circuit because between the heart and the lungs. So not too far, right? Short, distance is short. Systemic circulation is long circuit system. So those are the important differences between the pulmonary and systemic circulations. So I may ask you, tell me few important differences between the arteries and veins. Tell me a few important differences between the pulmonary and systemic circulations. Okay. Now we will try to identify the major arteries and veins in our body. First, we will try to see the major or important arteries in our body. This is the arterial system in our body. So we will talk about the systemic circulation. This is the systemic circulation. So we know that the left ventricle pumps the blood and blood enters into the aorta. Which part of the aorta will get the blood from the left ventricle? The ascending aorta. This part, ascending aorta. Short, will receive the blood from left ventricle, and the ascending aorta will turn like an arch, and that is called the aortic arch. Will turn leftwards, left and to the back, and that is the aortic arch. And then next part is very long, goes down, descends down. That's the descending aorta, right? Because it's descending, going downwards. So descending aorta is very long. So now if I ask you, the aorta has how many parts? Three parts. Ascending part is short, then aortic arch, and longest part is the descending aorta. Now, important branches of ascending aorta are coronary arteries. How many coronary arteries we have? Two, right and left. And they are the direct branches of the ascending aorta. Immediately after the ascending aorta comes out from the heart, two branches get out, right coronary artery, left coronary artery. So coronary arteries are direct branches of the ascending aorta. Remember that. Then, aortic arch. From the aortic arch, three large arteries arise. How many?
Three
large arteries arise. What are those? Brachiocephalic trunk, left common carotid, and left subclavian. So if this is the aortic arch, brachiocephalic trunk, then next one is left common carotid, and leftmost one is the left subclavian. So, three. This is the brachiocephalic trunk. This is left common carotid, left subclavian. Those are the three direct branches of the aortic arch. Now, you got left common carotid and left subclavian, right? Which are missing? Right common carotid, right subclavian. Right common carotid and right subclavian are direct branches of brachiocephalic trunk. So brachiocephalic trunk will divide into right subclavian and right common carotid. Okay? So now you got right and left common carotid, right and left subclavian. Right? Now, how many common carotids you got?
Two.
Two, right and left. When you will hear the term common in case of arteries, you should think that common means joining of two. Two are joining to form the common. Okay? So common will divide into two branches, usually. So common will do what? Will divide into two branches. So you got right common carotid, so it will divide into how many branches?
Two.
Two. Okay, very good. So one, two. This is left common carotid. It will divide into how many?
Two.
Two. One, two. Okay. So which two common carotid will divide into internal and external carotid? Okay. So this is right internal carotid. This is right external carotid. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And this is left, because this is left common carotid, so it will divide into left internal external carotid and left internal carotid. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So remember that common carotid will divide into external and internal. Okay? Is it clear? Okay. So now the internal will deliver blood. In general, internal will give blood to the inner part of your head, inner structures of your head. External carotid will deliver blood to the outer part of the head or outer structures of the head. Make sense? Internal means inner, right? Okay, so which one is the main structure inside your head? What is the main structure inside your head?
The brain.
So your brain will mainly get blood from the internal carotid. And your skull, your facial structures, those will get external blood from the external carotid. So that's the common idea, information. Okay, now subclavian, right and left subclavian. The subclavian, the term, think that sub means what? Below, right? Under. Clavian indicates the clavicle. So subclavian will run under the clavicle. Okay, so you have right subclavian, left subclavian. You have right, left subclavian, and right subclavian. Okay, so they will start to run under the clavicle and will move towards the upper limbs. Okay, so you see here, this is the clavicle, this is the subclavian. Okay, so from the subclavian, three arteries will be originated, will be formed. We'll talk about that later. Just know that from the subclavian artery, how many branches you get? Three branches, okay? Just remember. Then subclavian will move towards the upper limb. First, it will enter into the armpit, axillary area, and will become the axillary artery. So subclavian, when will enter into the armpit area, its name will become axillary. It will become axillary artery. And then from there, it will enter into the brachial part, right? This is the brachial part of the body. So it will become brachial artery. And in your forearm,
it will divide into radial and ulna arteries. Radial artery will run along the radius, and ulnar artery will run along the ulnar bone. So radial is laterally, ulna is medial. Right? So now, in the proximal part of your palm, this is the palm, proximal towards your body, proximal part of the palm, radial and ulnar will join like this. So this is radial going down, this is ulnar going down, and they will branch like this and will join. And will form two arches. You see one arch is here and another arch is here. One is outwards, that's the superficial one towards your palm. Another is in the back, that's the deep. So superficial and deep palmar arches, two arches will be formed. And from those palmar arches, number of branches will move towards the fingers or digits. Those are called the digital arteries. So you see here, the subclavian, axillary, brachial, medial, ulnar, superficial and deep palmar arches, and then the digital arteries. Okay, so that's about the upper part, your head and upper limbs. Now, so we have talked about the ascending aorta, we have talked about the aortic arch and their branches. Now, if you go to the third part of the aorta, that's the longest part, right? That is the descending aorta. Now, descending aorta can be divided into two parts. The part is located in the thorax, that's the thoracic aorta, and the part that is located inside the abdomen, that's the abdominal aorta. So descending aorta has how many parts? Two parts, thoracic aorta and abdominal aorta. And which structure separates those two parts? The diaphragm, you know that. Okay, so above the diaphragm is the thoracic aorta, below the diaphragm is the abdominal aorta. Thoracic aorta doesn't have important branches, just run down behind the heart and enters into the abdomen, becomes abdominal aorta. Abdominal aorta has a number of important branches, because we know that most of the important organs are, most of the organs of our body are located inside the abdominal cavity, right? So from the abdominal aorta, a number of branches get out, a number of distributing arteries get out. Now, I'll mention the important ones, important branches of the abdominal aorta. If this is the abdominal aorta, some branches get out from the anterior surface of the abdominal aorta, some branches come out from the sides of the abdominal aorta. Okay? So some are from the front, some are from the sides. So important anterior branches or branches come out from the front or anterior surface. The uppermost one, that's the celiac trunk. Trunk means short artery. Remember, trunk indicates very short artery. So short and wide. So celiac trunk is here. Very short trunk, and then celiac trunk divides and forms a number of arteries. Important branches of celiac trunk are splenic, we'll go to the spleen, hepatic, we'll go where? Liver, gastric, we'll go to the stomach, okay? So just remember that celiac trunk will form branches, and those branches will supply blood to the spleen, to the stomach, to the
liver. Okay? Then if you go down, another artery will get out from the anterior surface, that is called the superior mesenteric. Superior mesenteric. Superior mesenteric artery will give blood to the upper part of the intestine. So you have a small intestine and large intestine, right? Which one is above? Which one is below?
Small
is above, large is below, right? So upper part is the small intestine. So your small intestine will mainly get blood from the superior mesenteric, upper intestine or small intestine. Now inferior mesenteric will give blood to the lower intestine, that means the large intestine. So large intestine mainly get blood from where? Inferior mesenteric. Small intestine mainly gets blood from? Your stomach mainly gets blood from?
Gastric,
which is a branch of cilia, comes from cilia. So that's the anterior surface of the abdominal aorta. Now from the sides, important branches are kidney. Kidney will get blood via the renal artery. So the renal artery. Also you have above the kidney, you have a gland. What is that?
Suprarenal.
So suprarenal artery, renal artery, another artery will get out from the side, that is called gonadal. Will go where? To the gonads, testes and ovaries, right? Gonads are testes or ovaries, so gonadal artery is long artery. And also lumbar, L-U-M-B-A-R. Lumbar will give blood to the posterior muscle, posterior trunk muscles, or the posterior muscles of the lower part of the trunk or back muscles. Okay. So those are the important branches of the abdominal aorta. Got it? So abdominal aorta from the anterior aspect, you will get the ciliac trunk, superior mesenteric, inferior mesenteric. From the sides, important arteries are suprarenal, renal, right, gonadal, and lumbar. So
the ones that you just went all over, where do they all start? In the descending aorta or the?
This is abdominal aorta. Inside the abdomen, inside the, it is a part of descending, lower part of the descending aorta is the abdominal aorta, right? The descending aorta has two parts. Okay. So now, the lower end of the abdominal aorta will divide into two lower arteries. So, at the lower end, the abdominal aorta will divide into two lower arteries. Those are called common iliac. So you have right and left common iliac arteries. Common indicates what? It will divide into
two,
internal and external. So the common iliac will divide into each common iliac. We have two common iliacs, so we'll divide into external iliac and internal iliac. External iliac is much larger than the internal iliac, much bigger than the internal iliac, and will run down to the leg, to the thigh. Will move towards the lower limb. And internal iliac is much smaller, right? And will stay in the pelvic cavity. Where? Pelvic cavity. And will give blood to the pelvic organs. For example, your urinary bladder, your uterus, right? Those, your prostate, those structures
are located in the pelvic part, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they will get blood from the internal ilia, internally. External ilia will go to the thigh. And the thigh area is called the femoral area. You all know that this is the femoral part. So the name of that artery is femoral artery. So external ilia will enter into the thigh and will become the femoral artery. And then the femoral artery will run down. When the femoral artery will reach to the back of your knee, that area is called what? Back of the knee? Popliteal. It will become popliteal artery. Okay, so the name will change to popliteal artery. Then popliteal artery will is short, because popliteal area is short, right? Small. And will enter into the leg and will divide into anterior and posterior tibia. Anterior tibial and what?
Posterior tibial.
Which one will run in front of the tibia? The posterior tibial will run back. Okay. Now, posterior tibial will give a branch, important branch, that is called the fibular artery. So, posterior tibial will give a branch that is called large branch, that is called the fibular artery. So those are the three large arteries in your leg: anterior tibial, posterior tibial, and fibular. All three are large arteries in the leg. Okay? Then the anterior tibial and posterior tibial, what they will do, they will form two arches in the foot. Okay? Two arches. And the those are called plantar arches. Okay? Plantar arches. And superficial and deep plantar arches. And also another artery will be formed, that is called the arcuate artery. We'll see in larger picture how they form those. Just know that the anterior posterior tibial, they will form plantar arches and arcuate artery. And from the arcuate artery, the branches will move towards the digits. Okay? First, they will form the metatarsal arteries and will form the digital arteries. Those will go to the toes.
So that's about the lower part of the body. Now,
I told you to remember that subclavian, each subclavian has how many branches? Three. Do you remember? I said to remember, I didn't mention the name, I asked you to just remember that from the subclavian, three branches will come out. So what are those three branches? Here. The costo-cervical, chiro-cervical, and vertebra. This is the vertebra. This is the vertebra. So, I'm repeating again. Costo-cervical, chiro-cervical, and vertebra. Now, remember the name. Costo-cervical. Costo indicates what? Ribs. And cervical? Neck. Yes, neck part is the cervical part, right? Cervical part is the neck. So, costo-cervical trunk. Trunk means what? Short?
Short.
Short artery, right? Short artery is trunk. So, this costo-cervical artery is short artery and will divide, will branch into two branches. One will go to the ribs. Towards the ribs, you see here, costocervical trunk, short artery. One branch will go to the ribs, another branch will go to the neck part, right? That's why it is called costocervical. It will give blood to the rib area, the thoracic chest, and to the neck. Thyrocervical, now you can tell me, thyrocervical trunk. One branch will go where? To the thyroid gland, and another branch will go to the neck. Thyrocervical.
And hiatal valve artery is very important. This artery goes all the way to the brain. Okay, so vertebral arteries will go to the brain. Okay. So now, until now, you got two arteries supply blood to the brain. What are those two? Internal carotid and vertebral. Is it clear? Internal carotid and vertebral. Those two are the main arteries deliver blood to the brain, or blood goes to the brain through those two arteries. Internal carotid I have mentioned before, right? That will go to the inner part of the head and the vertebral. Okay, so that's about the subclavian and its branches. Now, how those two pairs of arteries supply blood to the brain? Before the blood goes to the brain, a circle is formed at the base of the brain. You are looking at the brain from the bottom. This is the bottom of the brain. You are looking from the bottom. So this is the bottom of the brain. And at the bottom of the brain, the circle is formed. That is called the circle of Willis. And from that circle, the blood goes to the brain. Now, how the circle of Willis is formed? Those I told you, that internal carotid and vertebral, those are the arteries taking blood towards the brain, right? So let's see what happens. You see, the vertebral arteries will join together, right and left vertebral, coming from right and left subclavian, they will join together at the junction of medulla oblongata and pons. This is the pons, this is the medulla oblongata, and will form basilar artery. So two vertebral will join to form the basilar artery. Okay, here. And these two are the internal carotid arteries. Okay? So from the basilar artery, a branch will go to the internal carotid. Better if we say an artery will connect the basilar and internal carotid, because we don't know which one it is, the branch of internal carotid or basilar, because it is connecting those two. We cannot tell it is the branch of which one because it is connecting those two. So internal carotid and basilar are being connected by the posterior communicating artery. Those two arteries are communicating each other through the posterior communicating arteries, the basilar and internal carotid. And from the internal carotid, a branch gets out anteriorly, and that is called the anterior cerebral artery. So this is anterior cerebral artery going like this. This is anterior cerebral artery going like this. And two anterior cerebral arteries are connected by a short artery that is called the anterior communicating artery. So now you've got posterior communicating that connects what? Basilar and internal carotid. And anterior communicating connects two anterior cerebral arteries. And anterior cerebral arteries are the branches of what? Internal carotid. Is it clear? Okay. So that is the circle. Circle is formed by the branches of basilar and internal carotid. And why that circle is important? The main significance of that circle is protection, protecting the brain. How? If any blockage occurs here, since it is circle, right? So the blood, instead of going this way, blood can go that way, because it is a circle. And many branches form. They are going inside the brain. Okay. So the brain will not be affected much if the blockage or clot is formed there. That is the main purpose. If the internal carotid and basal heart valve, they had gone directly into the brain, then any blockage will damage huge area, right? Will deprive a huge area in the brain. Because of the circle, the blood can take a different path or different route.
Okay. That's the circle of Willis?
Circle of Willis, yeah. Okay. Circle of Willis. Okay?
Doc, is the super renal also the adrenaline?
Yes.
It's adrenal also gland. That. Okay.
Yes, adrenal gland is suprarenal gland. Okay. And suprarenal artery is the branch that will go to the adrenal gland, right?
Okay. Thank you.
So, don't need to hear anything important here. Okay, so you see here the popliteal artery will divide into anterior and posterior tibial, okay? That I have already mentioned. Popliteal, the back of the knee will divide into anterior tibial, posterior tibial. Then from the posterior tibial, a large branch will get out, that is the fibular artery, okay? And see that the plantar arch is here. And plantar arch is formed by the branches of posterior tibial. Posterior tibial will divide. One will go medially, another will go laterally. The medial one is called medial plantar artery, lateral one is called lateral plantar artery, and those two will join and will form the plantar arch. Plantar arch is towards the sole of the foot, plantar surface, right? Sole of the foot is the plantar surface. And from there, the branches will go to the digits. Okay, now we'll talk about the major veins in the venous system. So we'll talk about the important veins in our body. Most of the veins are very similar to the arteries. So corresponding veins are present in our body, but some are different. So first, we'll see, remember, veins bring the blood towards the heart, right? So, better if we could have started from the smallest to the largest, but for you to understand better, we'll talk from the largest to the smallest, okay? So, we know that two largest veins are superior and inferior vena cava. Superior vena cava brings deoxygenated blood into the right atrium from the upper part of the body. Inferior vena cava brings deoxygenated blood into the right atrium from the lower part of the body. Okay? And superior vena cava is this one. It divides into two large veins, the right and left brachiocephalic veins. In case of arterial system, you got only one brachiocephalic trunk, right? In case of venous system, you have right and left brachiocephalic veins. They join together and form the superior vena cava. So we can say superior vena cava divides into right and left brachiocephalic veins. Okay? And from each brachiocephalic vein, three branches get out and move upwards. What are those? Those are the external jugular, internal jugular, and vertebral. So external jugular, internal jugular, and in between those two, this is the vertebra. Those three are going upwards, okay? External two jugular, external and internal jugular and vertebral.
from each brachiocephaly. And then the brachiocephaly, after giving those three branches, brachiocephaly will become immediately, will become the subclavian. Will become what? Subclavian. Some places you will see that they have mentioned that this part is also subclavian, first part of subclavian. So subclavian and brachiocephaly, somewhere they have met here, but it is continuation, okay? So brachiocephaly becomes subclavian under the clavicle back. At the joining of brachiocephalic and subclavian, three veins are coming out, two jugular, internal, external, and one vertical.
Okay, now internal jugular will collect blood from the inner part of the head, and external jugular will collect the blood, deoxygenated blood, from which part? The outer part of the head, similar to internal external carotid. There are some overlappings, but just in general, that's that. Now, the subclavian will move towards the upper limb, and from the last part of subclavian, the two large veins will arise and will enter into the upper limb. One is called the cephalic, axillary is the continuation of subclavian, that will become axillary, and two large branches will emerge. One is the cephalic and another is the basilic. So you see here, this is the subclavian, right? This is the subclavian, and it will become the axillary. Where is the axillary? Subclavian will become axillary, and two large branches, the basilic and cephalic. And after the subclavian becomes axillary, it will enter into the brachial part and will become the brachial vein. So subclavian will become axillary and will become brachial, and subclavian will also give two large veins. Those are cephalic and basilic. Is it clear? Okay. So now, if I ask you, in the upper, in the arm, in your arm, how many large veins are there? How many?
Three.
Which are those?
Axillary, brachial.
Axillary in the armpit, not in the arm. Axillary in the armpit, right? We know that axillary. Which three? Brachial, cephalic, and basilic. Make sense? All those three are large, pretty large veins, okay? So, those three. Now, cephalic and basilic will go all the way to the hand, to the palm. And you see here, the brachial will divide into, in the forearm, brachial will divide into, like brachial artery, right? This part is like the artery, will divide into radial and ulnar, okay? So subclavian will become axillary, will become brachial, will become radial and ulnar. Only difference here is two other large veins we see in the arm, in the upper limb, cephalic and basilic. Those two are not present in the arterial system, only in the venous system. Then, in the hand, the radial and ulnar, they will join to form the palmar arches. And from the arches, the distal veins will emerge. Okay, now the inferior vena cava collects the blood, deoxygenated blood, from the lower part of the body, and inferior vena cava is mainly located in the abdomen.
small part is in the thorax, mostly in the abdomen, and a number of veins are bringing blood into the inferior vena cava, like the abdominal aorta, okay, very similar. The renal veins will bring the blood, deoxygenated blood from the kidneys, right? You can tell the gonadal veins will bring blood, deoxygenated blood from the gonads, right? The lumbar veins will bring the deoxygenated blood from the muscles of the back. So those are the veins which bring blood into the inferior vena cava from the heart. Okay, just forget that. We won't talk about that. Hepatic vein will bring the blood from the liver. Okay? Splenic vein will bring the blood from the spleen. So those are the veins that will drain blood, deoxygenated blood, into the inferior vena cava. The renal, hepatic, splenic, so those are the veins. Superior mesenteric, inferior mesenteric. Superior mesenteric will bring deoxygenated blood from the small intestine mainly. Inferior mesenteric will bring deoxygenated blood from the large intestine. Okay, so very similar to the arterial system. Now, the lower end of the inferior vena cava will divide into like arteries, common iliac veins. So two common iliac, right and left, and common iliac will divide into external iliac, internal iliac. Internal iliac is smaller, will remain in the pelvic cavity, external will go to the lower limb, right? And will become what? Femoral vein, like the artery, it will become femoral vein. But here, in the lower limb, two other large veins are present that are not present in case of arterial system. One is the great saphenous vein, and another is the small saphenous vein. So let's see. So common iliac, external iliac, internal iliac. External iliac will become the femoral. See, external iliac will become the femoral, but from the upper part of femoral, a large vein. This is the longest vein in our body. This is the longest vein in our body. See here, from the upper part of femoral, it will be formed and will go all the way down.
Which vein is that?
That's the great saphenous vein. Okay? Longest vein in the body.
Why are there more large veins in the arms and legs than there are arteries? Like you said, like it has an extra one in the arm and the leg.
Oh, yeah, more in number, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. The many veins, arteries run in the deeper part of the tissues, and veins run both in deeper and superficial part of the. That's why the number of veins is more, but exactly I don't know why it is more. But yeah. If you know, just let me know.
Okay.
It's interesting. Extra large veins in the lower limbs, the great saphenous and small saphenous. Great saphenous is very long, that's the longest, goes all the way down to the foot, from the upper part of the thigh, goes all the way down to the foot. And now the femoral vein will become the popliteal vein, like the artery, and will give the anterior tibial, posterior tibial, those branches, and the small saphenous, this one, small saphenous will come out from the popliteal vein. This is the popliteal vein, and this is the small saphenous. Okay? The small saphenous is only in the leg, and great saphenous is running through the thigh as well as the leg. Okay? So now, if I ask you, let's see here. Here, another important vein, my favorite, don't forget that. You see, the cephalic, I told you cephalic will go all the way down, basilic will go all the way down, the upper lip. The front of your elbow, the cephalic and basilic are connected by a vein. That is called the median cubital vein. And median cubital vein is very superficially located, and that is a good vein to collect the blood for lab. Okay? We usually collect the blood from the median cubital vein, the front of your elbow. Cephalic and basilic. Okay, so in, if I ask you, in the thigh, which one is the main artery? Femoral artery, yeah? Which are the main veins? There are two large veins. One is the femoral vein, another is great saphenous vein, right? In the leg, you have anterotibial, posterotibial, and fibular arteries, but in the leg, you have an additional vein, that is what? Small saphenous. So you have anterotibial, posterotibial, fibular, as well as the small saphenous. Okay. So in your upper limb, you have two additional veins. Those arteries we don't have, the basilic and saphenous. Those are the extra veins we have. So let's stop here.
Small saphenous comes off the popliteal?
Yes.
Yeah. Next week, are we going to go over the venous drainage of the base of the brain?
Next, second.
Venous drainage from the base of the brain, like around the circle of Willis. Are we going to go over that?
There is no circle in the venous system.
But is there, well, yeah, because you always hear about the danger triad, like you ever have a sore in your nose or something, that you can get an infection, you can, you know, it can kill you in like a couple of days if you're not careful.
Yeah,
but
the sinuses probably are talking about the sinuses, the venous sinuses. We have more sinuses in venous system than the arterial system. Sinuses are the
business of the... I see. I always see these kids with these things in their noses and stuff. Because I guess, you know, the brain's so quick to your heart, you get into the carotid. So I actually had an elementary teacher that had a sore in his nose a couple days later.
So the chance of spreading infection in the sinuses.